Good morning. We want to welcome you to St. Thomas Episcopal Church virtually. We're glad to be gathering on this day in a new kind of way as we go through this time when all of us have been asked to distance from each other in order to keep the most people in our community safe. I know this is a really inconvenience, but then again, it's a way of us figuring out how to do community in a new way. We prepared a lovely service for this morning. And so if you'd like to have the bulletin, you can go to our website, www.stthomasop.org, and you can find the links there to download it if you'd like to go and participate with us. Also, we have someone who's monitoring our comments, so if you have prayer requests, if you have other things that you'd like to ask for, we'll have a special time of prayer towards the end of the service. And we'll include those on the service today. We'll have some time for reflective music as a prelude, and then our worship will begin. So again, we're glad that you joined us this morning, and we look forward to connecting with you in lots of different ways in the coming time.
With a song of praise to sing, you'll reach
Our opening hymn is Be Thou My Vision, so please stand. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Dearly beloved, we have come together in the presence of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, to set forth his praise, to hear his holy word, and to ask for ourselves and on behalf of others those things that are necessary for our life and our salvation. And so that we may prepare ourselves in heart and mind to worship him, let us kneel, if we're able, in silence, with penitent and obedient hearts, confess our sins, that we may obtain forgiveness by his infinite goodness and mercy. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought and word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. O God, make speed to save us.
O Lord, make haste to help us.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Psalm 95. Come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout for joy to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and raise a loud shout to him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the creation of the earth, and the heights of the hills are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands have molded the dry land. Come, let us bow down and bend the knee, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. Oh, that today you would hearken to his voice. Harden not your hearts, as your forebears did in the wilderness, at Meribah, and on that day at Massah, when they tempted me. They put me to the test, though they had seen my works. 40 years long I detested that generation and said, the people are wayward in their hearts, they do not know my ways. So I swore in my wrath, they shall not enter into my rest. Glory to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Please be seated as we hear our lessons for this day.
A lesson from the book of Exodus. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, but there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be standing there in front of you on the rock of Horeb. Strike the rock and the water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massa and Meribah, because the Israelites quarreled and tested the Lord, saying, "Is Lord among us or not?" The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's continue in unison as we pray the canticle. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord.
My spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his lowly servant. From this day all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has mercy on those who fear him in every generation. He has shown the strength of his arm. He has scattered the proud in their conceit. He has cast down the mighty from their thrones and has lifted up the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has come to the help of his servant Israel, for he has remembered his promise of mercy, the promise he made to our fathers, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Romans. Since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our suffering, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we are still weak, at the right time Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us, and that while we are still sinners, Christ died for us. Much more surely then, now that we have been justified by his blood, will we be saved through him from the wrath of God. For if while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us continue as we recite in unison Canticle 17. Lord, now you have set your servant free
to go in peace as you have promised.
For these eyes of mine have seen the Savior, whom you have prepared for all the world to see,
a light to enlighten the nations and the glory of your people Israel.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit,
as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
A reading from the book of John. Jesus came to a Samaritan city called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired out by his journey, was sitting by the well. It was about noon. A Samaritan woman came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." His disciples had gone to the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask a drink of me, a woman of Samaria?" Jews do not share things in common with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have no bucket, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our ancestor Jacob, who gave us the well, and with his sons and his flocks drank from it?" Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water, so that I may never be thirsty or have to keep coming here to draw water." Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come back." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you say that the place where people must worship is in Jerusalem." Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and is now here, when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father sees such as these to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, who is called Christ. When he comes, he will proclaim all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I am he, the one who is speaking to you." Just then his disciples came. They were astonished that he was speaking with a woman, but no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you speaking with her?" Then the woman left her water jar and went back to the city. She said to the people, "Come and see a man who told me everything I have ever done. He cannot." They left the city and were on their way to him. Meanwhile, the disciples were urging him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, "I have food to eat that you do not know about." So the disciples said to one another, "Surely no one has brought him something to eat." Jesus said to them, "My food is to do the will of him who sent me and to complete his work. Do you not say, 4 months more, then comes the harvest? But I tell you, look around you and see how the fields are ripe for harvesting. The reaper is already receiving wages and is gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. For here the saying holds true, one sows and another reaps. I sent you to reap that for which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labor. Many Samaritans from that city believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me everything I have ever done. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay with them, and he stayed there 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. They said to the woman, "It is no longer because of what you said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is truly the Savior of the world." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Well, good morning. This is probably one of the most difficult times for us because we are facing a challenge in our life that we can't see, we can't touch, and we can't really know what's going to happen. And I don't know if you heard, it's always interesting how the scriptures are chosen for us through our lectionary. And this particular week, we have this passage of the people in Exodus when they are moving through a wilderness and in the desert, and they find themselves without basic needs. And that basic need in this particular moment of the story is that they don't have water, and so they're thirsty. Probably most of us have enough water in our lives that that's not something we're thinking about, but something is being taken away from us out of an abundance of caution and an attempt to try to keep our society and all the people in our society safe. We're being asked to stay away from each other and to stay home and to be isolated. Being social is basic humanity. Being in groups, being connected, sharing meals, having parties, learning together, all these things. This is one of the most basic needs that all of us have. And for a time, we're being asked to stay back, to keep our distance, to not touch. I don't know about you, but I feel like the people in the story of Exodus, and I'm not too happy about this, and it's frustrating, and I miss it already. Even this morning as we gather for worship in a different way, we normally have hundreds of people here at the church. We'd share coffee, we'd see conversation, we'd catch up on the week and how things have been. And for a time, we can't do that physically. But fortunately, we live in a day and age in which we can connect in other ways, even though it's not quite the same. In that same story, the people are journeying through the desert, and they're really frustrated and they're scared. And they're all those things, because to not have water is to not have life. And they go to Moses, and Moses takes his concerns to God and says, "Look, God, this is a problem." He says, "Look," and God says to Moses, "I am leading you to living water. You will go to a place, you will touch a stone, and water will come forth, and that is my promise." We step forward to the gospel, and we have this wonderful story of the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well. And sometimes we lose the cultural aspects of this because a Samaritan and a Jew are bitter enemies. And in the society of Jesus' time, women and men would not socialize together. They would not touch each other. They would not be in close proximity unless they are married. And at this particular moment, Jesus encounters this woman at noon at the well. Now, you have to remember, this is not like our time where we go to our faucet and turn water on. If you lived in the time of Jesus, you would have had a well in your community, and everyone goes to that place to draw water. It's sort of like the Quick Trip, right? Just kidding. And so the people would have gathered. This is a place of community. And so for the woman to come at noon, but also for Jesus to be there and for them to have a conversation would have been scandalous. This is why the apostles later in the story are throwing a fit. Why would he talk to her? And there we are, and Jesus knows this woman. Knows her story, knows her sins, knows her brokenness. And even in that, Jesus offers grace and love and says, "You can have the living water that I will give you." I don't know if you heard this amazing piece of scripture that we have from some of Paul's writing. When we talk about our suffering and how all of this, how our suffering leads to something else. Paul knew suffering. He says, not only that, but if we boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts. And so maybe for this time, while we stay away from each other, while everybody's life is being disrupted, residents in nursing homes are not allowed to have even their family visit. The students at our schools and universities are being sent home, often without time to close their relationships with their friends. Some of them had just simply gone on spring break and received a letter that they can't come back. Our public schools are making difficult decisions about whether to continue school. Our students may have to go to school well into the summer. Businesses are having to adjust everything about what they're doing. Our medical professionals are stepping up in incredible ways to do everything they can to prepare for the potential onslaught of seriously ill patients in the medical centers. Social workers and others are trying to figure out how to keep critical programming going for those who are in desperate need of that same thing. Food pantries and soup kitchens are trying to figure out how to keep that need present to those who are hungry and food insecure. All of us, in every aspect of our life, are having to make changes we weren't prepared to make. So how do we take advantage of this in different ways? I can't determine that for you, but like what Paul says, we can find hope. We can endure this. We can support one another. We can reach out. We can do our best to stay healthy. And if we do, maybe we're going to learn all kinds of new things. Maybe we're going to figure out new and interesting ways to be community. And maybe we'll learn more on how to be together. Jesus says to the woman at the well, "You can have this living water." And that same living water is offered to us even on this day. So I think our challenge as people of faith is to not lose hope. I think our challenge as people of faith is to seek that endurance through this time of suffering. I think as a people of faith, we are called to do whatever it takes in this moment to reach out to others, to support one another, and to do what we can. Because that living water doesn't come from God in just any place. It comes from God through us, the church. So be that living water for others. Amen. Amen. Please stand, if you're able, and our service continues with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Show us your mercy, O Lord,
and grant us your salvation.
Clothe your ministers with righteousness.
Let your people sing with joy.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in you can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under your care.
And guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let your way be known upon earth.
Your saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten.
Nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God.
And sustain us with your Holy Spirit.
O God, you make us glad with the weekly remembrance of the glorious resurrection of your Son, our Lord. Give us this day such blessing through our worship with you, that the week to come may be spent in your favor through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Be our light in the darkness, O Lord, and in your great mercy defend us from all perils and dangers of this day. For the love of your only Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
O God, the life of all who live, the light of the faithful, the strength of those who labor, and the repose of the dead, we thank you for the blessing of the day that is coming and humbly ask for your protection through the coming night. Bring us in safety to the morning hours through him who died and rose again, your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. At this time, I'm going to invite our web minister, Kelly, to come forward to offer prayers that you have requested online.
Gracious and loving God, we ask for your blessing on Tanner as he undergoes chemotherapy. We ask for strength and guidance for our social workers, for our healthcare workers, for all those who are on the front lines of this crisis. Lord, we ask your blessing on the elderly and those who are most vulnerable in our society, for the poor, for those lacking health care, for those experiencing homelessness. We ask your prayers for high school and college seniors, for those who have other celebrations and life moments that are being upended. We ask your prayers for families with young children as they figure out new routines in their lives, as they discern how to talk with their young children about this crisis and how to protect their children. We ask your prayers for childcare workers as they navigate this. And finally, Lord, we ask that you bless, guide, and protect all of us. Help us to move outside of ourselves so that concern for the other becomes
our new daily. We ask your prayers for childcare workers.
Amen.
As they navigate this. And finally, Lord, we ask that you bless, guide, and protect all of us. Help us to move outside of ourselves so that concern for the other. We ask your prayers for child care workers.
Amen.
As they navigate this. And finally, Lord, we ask.
And now we'll sing our hymn. The day thou gavest, Lord, is ended. Let us pray the general thanksgiving together. Almighty God, Father of all mercies, we, your unworthy servants, give you humble thanks for all your goodness and loving kindness to us and to all whom you have made. We bless you for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for your immeasurable love in the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we pray, give us such an awareness of your mercies that with truly thankful hearts, we may show forth your praise, not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to your service and by walking before you in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory throughout all ages. Almighty God, you have given us grace at this time, with one accord, to make our common supplication to you. And you have promised through your well-beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, you will be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, our desires and petitions as may be best for us, granting us in this world your truth and in the age to come, life everlasting.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May the God of hope fill us all with all joy and peace in believing through the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Just a couple of brief announcements. One is, for the time being, we will not be gathering in large groups at St. Thomas. So please look for some announcements tomorrow about our Wednesday Lenten series. We're still gonna have it, but we're gonna do it in a new way, online. And so please be patient with us. Please check your emails. Also check our Facebook page and website, as we'll be making announcements as we move forward. Our intention is to continue to offer worship in this way until a time comes when the community can gather again in person. And so we'll have services at 5:30, 8:45, and 10:45 each week. You can also join me and others as we do Compline in the evenings, Monday through Friday at 8 p.m. And so I hope that you'll join us in different ways. Look for communications. We also are having a children's offering that will be posted soon. Adult Forum will attempt to meet through Zoom, and so you should have received a link in your email. Also, our youth group is going to meet tonight on Zoom as well. Please look for your emails from Mother Kelly. I believe they're gathering at 6:30 p.m. To have some conversation. Again, I would appreciate your patience as we do our best to navigate this difficult situation and come together as a church in many different ways. And I'm thankful to our vestry and other leaders who have been 100% supportive, and our bishop as well, in all that we're doing. Thank you for joining us this day, and we have our postlude for you to have some time of reflection and prayer. We'll see you soon.
Amen.